I would like to welcome Kara Goldin, who is the founder and CEO of Hitwater. Welcome, Kara.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thanks for being here. We're really excited to talk to you today. I know that this has been a really interesting journey for you, from the youngest of five children, born and raised in Arizona, to working various corporate jobs, and then about 16 years ago, leaving that behind to found Hint. And I'm also enjoying the BlackBerry Hint right now as we talk. So, but I wondered if you could just tell us a little bit about your path and your journey.
Yeah, so I'm the founder and CEO, as you mentioned, of this product, Hint, and it's an unsweetened flavored water. We'll talk about that in a minute, but I started my career in journalism. I graduated from school and ended up moving to New York. I wanted to be a writer. I wanted to be in journalism, and that didn't turn out exactly. I wanted to work at Fortune magazine. That was my goal, but it never really happened. And instead I worked at Time magazine and was recruited out of there to go to a company that was really considered kind of a late stage startup, which it's funny to think about CNN like that today, but this was in the early 90s. Ted Turner was still running around the office, which is crazy.
Our home state here, I'm in Atlanta, Georgia, so exactly. CNN is big here.
Exactly. Yeah, he was commuting between Atlanta and New York, and then I met my husband in New York, and he really wanted to get into technology law. He was very interested in technology, I think more interested in technology than law. And so he wanted to marry the two, and all the New York firms said, go west. And so we figured that we'd come to San Francisco for maybe a couple of years. And I was trying to figure out if I was going to stay with CNN or not, because it was in my mind like a satellite office versus kind of being in the home office. And so when I got to San Francisco, that's when I didn't know anybody in San Francisco. And for me, Steve Jobs was kind of the epitome of the guy that I thought of when I thought of Silicon Valley and San Francisco. And I kept trying to figure out how I could get a job in a technology company like Apple. I hadn't had, any of this experience. But as I was doing research for looking at what kind of companies I could, go to if it wasn't going to be Apple, that's when I stumbled upon this little startup that was doing CD-ROM shopping. They had spun out of Apple, five guys that had worked for Steve, actually, that were taking catalogs and putting them on a disc. And it was a little known Steve Jobs idea that I thought was really interesting. And so I cold called these guys, kind of hoping that maybe Steve might be in the office. I don't know what I was thinking. He never was. But that's when I, took the gentleman to coffee that picked up the phone. I figured, what else am I doing? I'm trying to figure out what I'm doing. And that's when I got a job offer. And I think something that I think about, and you'll probably relate to this during this meeting, was I don't even think it mattered to them what I did at Time magazine or CNN. They were so enamored by the brands that I worked for, right? Mm-hmm. They're all living in Silicon Valley. And they're like, really? Like, how did you get that job? And I'm thinking, okay, well, you worked for Steve Jobs. I mean, that is just super cool. They're like, oh, him? Okay. But anyway, let's go back. What's Ted Turner like, right? And right. It was a really interesting time. I ended up getting a job offer to basically go out to all of these retailers. You mentioned your early experience was Eddie Bauer. Eddie Bauer was one of our first merchants that we brought onto this disc, and that was called To Market. And about one of our investors was this company called America Online. And this was an online service that some of the competitors that I had heard of, never had heard of America Online, was CompuServe and Prodigy. And right. So they decided to acquire us. And so part of the acquisition was that some of us were invited to stay, and I was invited to stay and run this thing called Shopping Partnerships because of the partnerships that I had built on this little disc. So I did that for 7 years. I laugh because many of the stories of building this kind of, I called it an online mall, even before people were talking about this, was, you know, it was just a lot of fun. Like we had no idea what we were doing. There was no roadmap. I would, you know, come up with these ideas and these strategies, including that I needed to meet with like Westfield Mall, right? Because I needed to understand how they would think about things. And I heard about anchor tenants and, you know, and that, you know, if you get like a J. Crew in, then you'll definitely get these others because that's, you know, they follow each other on. So that was the strategy. I had no idea, no experience, but I just went and did it. Anyway, 7 years later, it was $1 billion in revenue to AOL. Wow. And there were, you know, 200 people working with me on my team. And that's when I thought, I'm spending so much time away from my family in San Francisco. I had been through this hockey stick, which, you know, huge growth. And things were starting to level off. Thankfully, they weren't, you know, nosediving, but I felt like I had this stuff that I was missing back in San Francisco. I had 3 kids at the time under the age of 4. And so I really like hopped off the train at that point. And so many people kept saying to me, why are you doing that? I mean, why are you leaving? You're a successful tech executive. You're the youngest vice president in AOL. You're one of the few females. Why are you doing that? And I go back and think about that. And, you know, I think it was because I wasn't learning at the same capacity. I had been putting myself into positions where, you know, calling it Undaunted now, where you just go out and learn and you enjoy it and you have fun, but it ends up that that's not what people do. It's not that I didn't have some bad days or didn't have some challenges. I would laugh along the way and I would kind of keep thinking in all of these different roles that maybe somebody will find me out eventually and they'll kick me out. I mean, I just never took it that seriously. I just kept doing what I was doing because I just thought, I'm meeting with like the CEO of Eddie Bauer. I mean, it's crazy, right? The conversations and Mickey Drexler from The Gap. I mean, friends would say, you're kidding me. I mean, this is crazy. So anyway, that's kind of where I ultimately got to thinking about my own health. I was taking a break and I was drinking a ton of diet soda. Never really thought that was a problem. I was having some stomach issues, but more than anything, I'd gained a bunch of weight over the course of a few years and consistently with all my pregnancies, couldn't lose the weight.
Wait, diet soda is supposed to keep you thin, isn't that right?
Well, this is what I thought too. And I had been, you know, you and I were talking a little bit earlier where, you know, I was an athlete. I was a gymnast. I had been drinking Diet Coke since the early 80s, thinking that that was just fine. I mean, that I wasn't doing anything wrong because it was diet. And that I never thought about taking a look at it. And when I finally decided to do a quick swap just to see what would happen, a few things happened. Number one, I realized I was really thirsty because I was no longer drinking my drink that I was drinking throughout the day. So I started drinking water. And I think at one point I looked at my family and I said, water is so boring. I don't know if I can do this any longer, but I did it. I stuck with it for a couple of weeks. And that's when, you know, lots of health changes came about. I, you know, cleared up my skin, my energy levels went up. I lost over 20 pounds in 2 weeks. My body was ready for that change. And I think that it was, you know, for me, it was shocking because I thought I had been doing all the right things. I had been marketed to, right? Diet in my mind was health. And yet when I looked for this product that I had been creating now in my kitchen to make water taste better with just fruit and water, I was shocked that the product wasn't in stores. I never sat there and said, I'm going to go be an entrepreneur. I'm going to quit this tech job. I'm going to, you know, go and take on, you know, the big soda or any of those things. For me, I just wanted this product on the shelf. And I just couldn't believe that I had been fooled. And I thought that in kind of sharing my story with friends, most people thought the same thing that I did, that diet soda was better. And then when I would share stories, even like about another product that was on the shelf, vitamin water, which was super hot 16 years ago.
Yeah.
People couldn't believe it had that much sugar in it. I mean, there wasn't even a diet version of that product. And so anyway, that was the point when I thought, if I could actually create a product that has just fruit and water in it and get people to buy it, then maybe that would help people get healthy. And well, that would be pretty darn cool to do.
Yeah, I know you call yourself the unintentional entrepreneur, but I can tell you that I think that the most successful entrepreneurs are the ones who just want to solve a problem in the world versus trying to make money or trying to, you said you never were trying to take on big soda, but you were trying to solve a problem for yourself. And then you thought, you know what? A lot of other people probably would want to solve the same problem in the same way.
Yeah, definitely. And that was it. I mean, you know, I think it's actually incredibly scary and daunting to think I'm going to go take on big soda. I'm going to go be an entrepreneur. But instead, what I realized is just by going out and doing what seemed logical to me and taking a few steps forward, I started, you know, to be somewhat surprised, even getting my product on the shelf at Whole Foods. I mean, that was kind of shocking. I mean, there was a part of me that thought, how am I going to do that? But then I just got in the car and I went there and I tried to figure it out, right? And I think so often people, whether you look at it from an age perspective or, you know, getting more senior and kind of their role within an organization, we lose the ability to really focus on learning. And I think what I really saw when I think back, as Steve Jobs used to say, you know, eventually the dots connect, right? I think that when I think back on sort of where my head was when I was leaving AOL, it was, I wasn't learning at the same level when we were going through a hockey stick. And when I saw this opportunity in the beverage industry based on something that I was really interested in, that I had figured out how to solve my own problem, I thought, gosh, that's just so interesting. And every day there was just this new thing that I would discover. And I mean, I think today my sort of push for entrepreneurs or would-be entrepreneurs is, you know, stop worrying about what you can't do, start figuring out, you know, how to go make something happen. Because if nothing else, you know, it's headed towards something that you're interested in, you're curious in, and you will learn every time we go out and challenge ourselves in some way. You might learn that you're not really that interested in it, right?
Yeah,
or,
yeah, yeah.
I mean, you can look at it a lot of different ways, but yet people, the older we get, the less time we consciously focus on putting ourselves into positions where, you know, we're not the most knowledgeable person in the room, right? We're supposed to, like, with age, with seniority, we're supposed to be the most knowledgeable. I purposely hire people that know more than I do. In fact, I was just talking about this morning to somebody on my team that I said, you know, I don't think any of us want a person on the team that we're teaching. We have a lot of people that we're teaching, which is great, but we want somebody who knows more than we do. And I think that that perspective, people don't take the time to kind of embrace that enough.
Well, I want to talk about the book in a minute, but actually I want to, before we jump into that, you've led me to one of the other questions I want to ask, which is, what would you say your superpower is? Is it hiring people that know things you don't, or is it something else?
Well, and I think
by the way, before you answer, I also wanted to say, in the book, I know you mentioned that early on your father, you used to kind of annoy your father because you thought you always thought that a no meant maybe, and that a maybe was kind of a yes. And so I think that may be a skill that as an entrepreneur, you know, knowing how to sell and being, not taking no for an answer is certainly a skill. I don't know if that's the one you're going to choose, but I think that's an important skill for you.
Yeah, well, it's interesting because, you know, my dad used to say that to me all the time. And obviously it has different connotations to different people, especially with the whole Me Too movement. So it's not headed in that direction for sure.
Right.
In this case, but it's, Yeah, I mean, I would say that it's probably for me curiosity, because I always wanted to, and I really think that that stems even on how I encourage our managers to build out their teams. And, you know, that if you're not curious, if you're not having, if you definitely need contributors on your team, but it's the most important thing is to always be learning. And it doesn't matter what you're, you know, if you're a vice president and you're hiring a director, I mean, you can actually hire directors on your team that you don't know exactly everything that they're doing, right? That it should be one of these roles where you're actually, you know, you're curious about different things and people will show you things. I mean, if you think about people that you've managed in the past, that's where your engagement comes in, right? And yet people don't really focus on that. And it's one of the chapters in the book is one of our best employees. I mean, when I said, what does this person know that you don't know? And he said, what? Why would I mean, why would I hire somebody that that is smarter than me? I mean, are you crazy? I'm going to, you know, they're going to move me out of my job. And I said, no, I mean, you can't think about it that way. There's plenty of great workers, performers, however you want to, managers, however you want to view it, there will always be room for you. Don't worry about that. But instead, it allows you to go and learn and then move on to go learn more from other people. And so I think it's definitely a superpower. It's not something, I think what I always find humorous is, especially when we hire people who have not been trained to think this way, that maybe have other skills, and they come into the organization, it really kind of, you know, you have to sort of think about it a little bit, and it kind of hits every one of your insecurities, right? You, again, it goes back to, we don't want people that are just going to be able to do a job and a task, because I think you'll burn out on that after a while, because you'll learn that job and then, you know, you won't be learning yourself. And if, I don't know about you, but I mean, any of my friends or colleagues, coworkers that I've worked at in the past, when they're really, you know, not the happiest people, maybe the most frustrated, not really sure if they want to stay in their role, it really boils down to, you know, this curiosity as well as this desire to just go out and learn.
And I think maybe what I'm also hearing is that if things get stale for you, if you aren't growing and learning, and you know, you want to constantly be stimulated with something new, which I'm sure in your current role, you know, the industry is evolving, the business is evolving. We're wrapping up now, you know, the days of pandemic, hopefully wrapping it up as everybody's getting vaccinated, but you know, you want to keep growing and evolving.
Absolutely. And it's, you know, I think for many people who have children too, we're always encouraging people to go out and try and learn things. Yet at some point that breaks, right? And I think it's the way people are. I think it's the workforce, and I think it needs to be broken. And I think more people need to subscribe to this as well, that it's just, you know, hiring people in doesn't mean that they're, you know, less effective as you or less skilled as you. So
right.
I think that is, again, my own curiosity.
Great. So I want to talk for a minute about the book. I have it here, Undaunted. So I'm curious, just what was your reason for writing the book? And also, what do you hope that readers get out of it when they read it?
Yeah, so I, you know, was doing a ton of public speaking and traveling, and I started journaling, and the journaling really stemmed from a lot of talks that I was doing where people would, you know, there'd be the Q&A at the end and people would ask questions, and I would use those questions as my prompts to actually, you know, write in my journal every night. And, you know, I found that there were different stories that I would share in, you know, in this journal initially, that really helped people to kind of break through or get started. And I thought that if I could actually just get these stories out there, I was initially thinking just to bind the journal and just give it to people, because I just thought, you know, the frustrating thing was that companies would hire me to come in and share the story, or, you know, I'd be speaking on campuses or whatever. And there were a lot of people that really needed help that wouldn't go to those conferences, that wouldn't work inside those companies and wouldn't be in that, you know, on that campus. So I thought, how do I reach them? And part of it, I would start sharing some of these stories through social. But then in addition to that, I thought I should just like get it out there. So I talked to a friend who was an author, and she said, you should just like, you should publish the book. And I said, that's scary. That's very daunting. I mean, how do I have time to do this? And she said, what are you talking about? You've written 600 pages. And I was like, maybe, I don't know. But I think that the other piece of actually writing a book that I've shared with friends of mine who have talked to me about writing a book is that it was a learning experience. I mean, I knew about the book industry. I knew that there were a few publishers out there, but I didn't know all the different ways. I didn't understand the economics of it. I did all of these things. And so I thought, oh, okay, well, I'm going to learn. And I mean, it's funny, even my publisher had given me this deck at the very beginning that just seemed like a foreign language to me. I had no idea what they were talking about. I remember glancing at it and I was just looking through it and I just thought, oh, I know what all these things are now. It really wasn't that complicated. And yeah, so it was, but you know, it really stemmed from very similar to my product, being curious about something, but also feeling that I could help people by doing it.
Well, And so I want to talk a little bit about, you know, some of the themes. So it's named Undaunted, Overcoming Doubts and Doubters. And so I know that you have talked a lot about in the book and both, you know, publicly about doubts that you had within yourself and also doubts that you were hearing from external. So I'm curious about, you know, how did you work those into the book? I assume it was partially because you wanted to help other people that were also experiencing similar feelings.
Yeah. And I felt like, you know, just in my journal, I would talk about, I remember going into the beverage industry and meeting every once in a while, I'd go to these trade shows and I'd meet people from, you know, who worked for these brands and founders that I just thought were godlike. You know, they had been successful and, you know, they just knew I didn't even know their background. They just had, you know, been attached to a brand and therefore they were, you know, they had it all figured out. And I would hear different things. And I often think back on these times where I'm not even sure it was intentional, but they would say, for example, you know, you'll get into Target, but never get kicked out of Target. And I thought, why? And they'd say, because that you're done. I mean, if you ever get
you never get back in, right.
We've been kicked out of Target 9 times over the last 16 years. And for a variety of reasons, we've had, you know, the soda companies have paid off probably, and, you know, who knows, right? They buy more space, they buy more marketing, whatever it is. And so what I've realized is that some things happen that are out of your control, and where they really start to bother you is that if that's the only game in town, right? So it's a combination of a few different stories. One, it's the doubters, right? The first time I get kicked out of Target, I'm like, okay, we should just close up shop and I should be looking for another job, right? And then what I realized is that actually what happened in that situation was Coca-Cola was launching a new product and they were the category captain. You've done retail before, so you understand these terms. They had negotiated space and it was their space and they wanted to be the only unsweetened flavored water in the store. So although we had been doing well in Target, we were removed from Target. It wasn't fair, but it was life, right? And unfortunately, you know, that was a bad day, right? It was a disruption. It wasn't great, but it was also because that was the only thing that we were doing. I mean, that was a big chunk of our business. And so a few months later, we got a phone call from the Target buyer, and she said, great news. Coke is not interested in doing this product anymore that they had.
They came and went, right.
And we are really interested in bringing you back in. And in addition, we're going to not only put you in, but you get more space. And so this was this concept too of, you know, people would also share with me, the industry experts, that that, you know, the big guys will crush you, right? Because they have more money, more experience. But now I would say to entrepreneurs, actually, it's less likely that the big guys, you should watch what they're doing, but it's the little guys. It's the hungry ones.
Yeah,
it's the ones
yeah,
that are, yeah. Right. And have the mission and are really scrappy and you don't see them coming. Right. Yeah. And they're the ones that are, they're the ones really to worry about. And so again, there's so many of these stories where I would start out with a doubt and then I would just let it play out. And then also look back on those experiences and try and figure out, what did I learn? How was I doubting myself? How was I feeling about these things? And what could I do differently? And, you know, in the case of this, what I share with entrepreneurs is, you know, put the only hedge that you have in that situation is to pay attention to the retailer target in this case, but also have other options.
Yeah,
because right. Otherwise, things are going to come along. I mean, a pandemic's going to come along for yeah. people, right? And there's things that you can't do, that you know, can't control when stores are closing. But what are the things that you can do that are in your control? And one question I, you know, always sort of follow up, especially when I'm having doubts, which I still have them to this day, is mm-hmm. what can I do? What can I do here? And, you know, if you sit there and lead with that question every time you're doubting yourself, you're doubting your situation, then what I think you will realize is that you will figure out a way to move forward. Maybe not far, but you may be able to say, I've got to figure out how to have more competition out there. I've got to, you know, in order to grow my category, I've got to figure out what other retailers I can get into, whatever the situation yeah. is. I've got to figure out online commerce, whatever that is.
So all your eggs aren't stuck in one basket.
Totally. Yeah.
So you give a lot of fantastic advice in the book in terms of just stories from your life that led to learning moments for you that helped mm-hmm. somebody maybe not having to go through all those situations personally, but learning from your book. So, but what's a one piece of advice that you wish somebody had really given you earlier in your career that would have been really useful at this point?
I think just the concept of, I was always trying, right? I was always going out and figuring it out. And, you know, I think for me being the last of five kids, I was always wanting to, you know, be older. I always thought life was unfair because, you know, my brothers and sisters, all I viewed the world as they had more money than I did to go to the mall. Right.
Right.
That was as far as I got. But I think no one ever told me just go try and just go figure out that there are a million different things that you can do. And that the trick is figuring out what are those things that you really enjoy doing every single day. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, I realized when, you know, I just set off on my journey to go find a job. I mean, that wasn't, you know, I had over 90 job interviews right after college. And so many people have asked me about that, and including President Crow, he thought that the school had set up a lot of these interviews. I'm like, no, I just kept asking people along the way. I would tell people
my hustle. Story.
Right. It was hustle, but it was also, I was intrigued. I was curious. Yeah. We didn't travel a lot as kids. I mean, we drove out to between Scottsdale and San Diego and Los Angeles. That was like my world. But all of a sudden in college, I met all these people from all these different cities. And there was kind of different personalities that I would pick up on for people who grew up in Chicago versus New York. And Miami that I thought, oh, that's really interesting. Maybe I'll go there one day. And so that was kind of, again, going back to this curiosity, but also, and the hustle, but also just this like desire to just go learn and just go try. Yeah. And I think that, you know, that's something that whenever I'm speaking, especially on college campuses, I'm like, you know, none of us really know what we're doing. right? I mean, this is something that, at least the people that are really honest with themselves, they go out, the most interesting entrepreneurs are the ones that they just go try. And then they're very aware if they're headed in a certain direction, maybe they're turning right. And then they don't want to make the same mistake twice, right? At twice, they start saying, I got to pivot. I've got to go in another direction. I think tech is excellent at sort of owning that and, you know, saying that nothing is ever going to be perfect. There's going to be 2.0. There's going to be, all of these different terms. What I think growing up in that, after college, that allowed me to take that sort of trial that you're never going to have perfection. It can always be better into the beverage industry, in an industry still think that, really when you launch Coca-Cola, you let it sit on the shelf for years and years and years, right? You don't want to disrupt it. It's, it's working. So why challenge it at all? And then you start disrupting in the beverage industry when it's not working, when sales are going down, right? It's like, it's a totally different thinking than what, the tech industry, how they view the world.
Absolutely. And, you think about, you made a really strong point about the fact that you don't have to worry about the behemoths as much because they're not the ones that are really innovating. It's the startups that are coming up with something fresh and new. I mean, Blockbuster was a pretty established business for a long time until Netflix came along, right?
Yeah. And it's always what I think is so, jump on to, that industry in particular. I mean, I think a lot about, the digital industry. I mean, how many times did people come into Kodak and say, there's Shutterfly, I wasn't working in there, but I'm sure it happened.
Yeah.
And yet,
I think Kodak bought Ophoto, was like an online photo, and it was kind of too late.
It was too late. But even before then, I mean, they heard about digital. They heard, but they refused to innovate. And that's the problem, I think, that I see inside of large companies is that they've got people who have been there for a long time and they do the same thing over and over and over again. And going back to this concept of really making sure that we're always learning. I mean, you've got people inside of large companies that are being, hailed as doing awesome because of revenues, because of Wall Street,
right?
Whatever it is, but they're not actually instead celebrating the win and then figuring out how do they get better. And that's something that, I'm constantly thinking about inside. People say, oh my gosh, BlackBerry, it's super great. We sit there every single day. We may not tell customers this, but we're always like, how can it be better? What else can we do? We are never done. And it's just, I would say that somebody asked me the other day, there's the superpower question, but then there's what is your fault? And I said,
what's your kryptonite? Patience. What's your kryptonite?
Patience. I said, because I always set myself up for challenges and I want it done tomorrow. And but I know I'm not going to get it done tomorrow, but that doesn't mean that I don't want it. Right. So that is my challenge.
So that's a great transition. I want to ask you a couple of questions about leadership. What's the most important value that you demonstrate as a leader or a value that you look for in people that you hire or work with?
So, it's interesting because I always encourage entrepreneurs and also managers in our organization to have goals, but I always think about it as you can move away from that goal depending, because there will be situations that come into it. So don't be so hard and fast that that's what the goal is, because I think that that's where you really run into trouble. You make, mistakes, you do things for the wrong reasons because you're trying to hit your number or whatever it is. Instead, I want people who are really curious. And, it's interesting. You look around our organization, we have about 200 people in the company now, about 50% of our revenue is direct to consumer. And so we have a very tech enabled company. Every other year, we bring the entire company together for an offsite. And we usually go back to Arizona, and I get to tell all my Arizona stories, and some of my brothers show up and, you know, mm-hmm. laugh about, you know, crazy Kara and all this stuff. But it's interesting because so many people don't really know that these other aspects of the company exist. I mean, they kind of know that we sell in Target, for example, and we've got people that are, you know, sales, street sales people that sell in, but then we've got other people that are managing SEO, mm-hmm. right? That are they don't even know what each other really does. And when I bring them all together, it's so fun because this learning comes into play. And it's very, very fun to kind of watch it. So I would say that curiosity is something that is, if you are not curious, you are not going to do well at Hint, because I think that it really is a company that people are, you know, really interested in asking questions, and for the most part, you know, don't think that what they do is the most important, you know, thing and the only thing, that it's really about, you know, understanding all the pieces come together, and that's what makes it successful.
Love it. So set up, my business is a marketing matchmaker, and that in practice typically means we connect brands and marketing agencies together. And so I'm curious, just generally, how you work, do you work with marketing agencies today? And if so, how do you work with them? And then the second question I'll ask you is, are there certain disciplines that you absolutely would never ever outsource outside of the company? And are there certain things that you would always want to outsource because you want to get that external perspective?
Yeah, you know, we've definitely used agencies over the years, depending. We also have an internal creative department because mm-hmm. we do a lot of, you know, digital ads where it's, we've got a formula down and there's tweaks. And so we'll do, you know, more of a, it's less about new and it's more about existing. And so we've got a creative department that's going to do a lot of that. But I think, you know, when it comes down to, for example, copywriters, and, you know, I think that oftentimes, you know, you just need new ideas, right? Yeah. And so we'll use agencies for that. In addition, I think that especially as technology ends up, you know, changing so frequently over the years, I think that it's hard to hire, you know, somebody in that can kind of know as much, right, as some of these companies do. I mean, you look at AI, for example, and so much that AI is doing for even messaging and picking up on, you know, little pieces of things, and also data. I mean, I think that we've become a data company over mm-hmm. the years as well. I mean, for the last, I guess, almost 9 years now, we started a direct-to-consumer business. And while we sell in, you know, retail stores, we also sell on Amazon, and we also sell on drinkhint.com. And so there's a lot of data that is different types of data, and how do you look at it? And, you know, and how do we, at the end of the day, really service the customer? So definitely, you know, I don't think I would ever say that we would never do an agency for any particular role, because I think it just depends. And yeah. I think that the other thing that I really encourage our team to do in all roles throughout our journey is, as a manager, always know how to do something, because I think that that's where you run into trouble. If you're relying on an agency, for example, to do SEO, and you don't actually understand what SEO is, it's not going to work out well. It just won't. Right. And you're like, well, that agency does it or whatever. You really have to, all of our managers are encouraged to roll up their sleeves and really understand, you know, a lot. And I mean, a lot of people have, you know, talked about me as a visionary CEO, a visionary leader, very in touch with the brand, but that's because of who I am too. And sort of rolling up my sleeves and being curious and wanting to know every aspect of it. I mean, our original website that we had at drinkhint.com, it was terrible. on so many levels. And I built it with my husband. I mean, we sat there on a weekend. It was like before Shopify, it was, I mean, it was terrible on a lot of levels, but it worked, right? And people are like, how did you know how to code? I'm like, it was awful. I mean, it wasn't great, but it wasn't that hard. I mean, I think I'm always looking for people that want to understand it, but just don't have bandwidth. That's the best thing. That is the best time to go and hire an agency when, you know, you just don't have the bandwidth, where it will be too expensive to get multiple people to be able to do this. And also to my patience factor, to be able to do it faster.
Quickly, sure. Well, we often say that the kind of the reasons that brands hire an agency is either capacity, right? Mm-hmm. You just don't have enough arms and legs to do the stuff you want to get accomplished from a marketing perspective, or capability. There's, you know, it just doesn't make sense to have an expert in every single discipline within marketing on the team. And so sometimes you find expertise outside of the organization from a discipline expert, you know, that knows their craft. So Kara, tell me if there was a particular campaign or program that you've run from a marketing perspective that either you were super proud of and excited about, or maybe it wasn't such a success and it really taught you something that you really wanted to learn or know.
Yeah. So a couple of years ago, we had decided to do a creative that basically was going to turn into a digital campaign that we were maybe going to use on Facebook and primarily leading people into not only knowing more about Hint, but also getting to buy Hint. So it was really more focused on direct to consumer than anything else. And we had a little bit of budget. We hired an agency and got it shot. And it was funny because I just run into a friend who I used to work at CNN with, and I reached out to her and I said, I heard that the Super Bowl was totally sold out. And do you know if there's any inventory? And we didn't have, you know, the $5 million or whatever it was, but I was just curious. I don't know what I was asking. And she said, oh, my friend works over at Fox Sports. You should reach out to him. And so I did. And he, you know, knew I was living in San Francisco, and he said, oh, I'm actually at the 49ers game right now. I may actually, you know, if you guys are in, maybe, you know, you should buy the ad. I said, oh yeah, right. I don't have, you know, $5 million. And he called me back. The 49ers won, and he called me back and he said, you know, you should look at maybe buying the San Francisco market. And I said, oh, that's really interesting. And so, you know, reached out, he had a broker reach out. Anyway, the net of it is that I started reaching out to all these locals. And before I even told our marketing team, I said, you know, what if we could spend like $1 million and get the reach of, you know, 60% of the market, would you do it? And I mean, the entire office looked at me and they just said, she's hallucinating. Again, she's never, this is never going to happen. I said, we have an ad and we have a great ad and it would just be so crazy. Let's do it. Well, anyway, the net of it is that we ended up getting, I think, over 70% of the US for, I mean, this is the real story. And it was just over $1 million. Because what I learned is that as you let the clock kind of run out for ads, that you've got people that are willing to deal. And that's what we were open to. And we just kept, and again, having my experience from CNN and really understanding that the, you know, the artwork needs to run, it's all timing. And then it also happened with the NFL. And I mean, it was just a lot of stuff that my knowledge of that, I didn't know why I knew it exactly, but I did. And so, 70% of the market, we end up, you know, getting on, we knew that we were going to run just right before halftime, but it could be anywhere from like half an hour to minutes before halftime. And it was, there was one commercial right before the halftime show, but we were right there. I mean, it was unbelievable.
That's amazing.
What I didn't realize, I kept, you know, I was really excited. We got the sale, right, of the, you know, we got all the inventory that we wanted. We were really focused on the sales aspect. what I didn't really know that was that that ended up occurring. I didn't predict that this was going to happen. I remember sitting on the sofa and watching, you know, the ad come up. It's really exciting. All of a sudden, my phone got so hot that it actually turned off because of all the people all over the US and customers and my team. The amount, I would have paid just to have my team see that they had a Super Bowl ad.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That the power, it wasn't just about the sales. It was just the power and the, we did it, the underdog, right? And the customers saying, oh my gosh, like they're doing a Super Bowl ad. So there's, I guess the net of it is that this, that to do that kind, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that, that sort of happened, but there's a lot of stuff that ends up happening that you just don't predict that is good, right? That came from it. An ad campaign is not, you know, it definitely is brand awareness and all those things, but actually your existing customers seeing that they've been supporting something that is, you know, they're in the know, right? They're the early adapters, right? They're fine. They knew about us. They're telling all their friends, Oh, I've been drinking Hint for 10 years.
It validates their early adoption.
Right. Yeah. And then they become your super fans.
Yeah.
Right. Because they see that they were there early. And so that's what we've seen. And those are the people then who were like on social and being, I mean, we had no idea that that's, and of course the campaign was amazing and everything, you know, sort of fell into place. But I think that it worked much better and it worked. In addition, it worked differently than I would have ever predicted.
Mm-hmm. It, you know, it's sort of like when you are a fan of a little local band and then they blow up and become and you're like, I remember when I saw them in a little club with 30 people and now they're playing stadiums. But in some ways you are super proud that you were an early adopter. In some ways you're a little bit, you know, feel a little bit like your secret is out to the rest of the world.
And you're kind of, you know, annoyed. So where have you guys been? I mean, I've been here for years anyway, so it's.
Right, everybody jumping on the bandwagon now that you know, they're a huge hit. So that's actually a really good, I'm gonna go to a couple of fun questions. The first is, other than Undaunted, which is a great read for anybody that is out there that needs a great inspirational book, but is other than Undaunted, is there a movie or a book or a quote or a band that really inspires you?
So many. You know what I've gotten really hooked on lately that actually, I won't go into that, but I'll talk about Sting has always been, I mean, I'm such a huge, anyone who knows me knows that I'm just a fanatic on so many levels. And I was just listening to, I think it was on Audible, but he just did kind of a sort of like behind the music type of thing. And I learned things about Sting that I didn't even know, and how he got the name Sting, for example. I mean, all these like, you know, little things.
He was dressed like a bumblebee or something, right? And his friends said he looked like a bumblebee.
Well, yeah. And people used to tease him. Right. Yeah. And then he decided I have a choice. I either, you know, sit there and, you know, highlight it, or I just kind of answer to it and just kind of move along because it's really not that important to me. And anyway, I love, there's so many stories that he has about, you know, challenges and strength and, you know, and endurance and doing what he feels is right. I mean, I saw him actually right before the pandemic. In San Francisco, he was in his the play that is now I'm drawing a blank on the name of it, but it's one of his. Anyway, I've seen it twice. I saw it in New York on Broadway, and then he decided he wanted to act in it. And he said, you know, he doesn't choose to do movies anymore. He doesn't enjoy movies. He enjoys theater. And so if he does anything outside of music, it's about storytelling and about feeling the audience. And anyway, I just find that somebody who just finds their passion and finds what they really enjoy, I think that that's what I really respect about him.
By the way, I think you and he share a trait that's probably served you both really well throughout your careers. You talked about it very early, writing, being a good writer. if I could give advice to young people to something to really focus on becoming really great at early, it's
totally agree.
Writing. I mean, because you're going to write for your entire career, no matter what field you're in. And the better you can do it, the better, you know, your output will be.
It's so true. No matter, you know, that I would say that my husband really enjoys writing as well. And he was one of two editors on my book. And, you know, as an attorney, he wrote a ton, right? And he was an attorney, he's our chief operating officer now, but definitely, you know, writing and everything you do, I think it's important to be able to write. And how many people are actually afraid of writing? It's really interesting, right? And, you know, it's really, you just got to start and just try. Yeah.
I fear a little bit for our next generation that writes in emojis and with shortened words and things. I hope that they take this to heart and really focus on being, you know, persuasive writing and good writing. So where do you find joy outside of work?
Well, I think like everybody in the world right now, travel. I love traveling and I love experiencing places, new places where I don't know all the answers, where, you know, I very rarely go back to places that I've already been. I really just take it all in. And also just, I think nature as well. What I realized is growing up in Arizona, I spent a lot of time outside. We didn't have, you know, a giant house. There was 7 people in our family, right? So it was just, I spent a lot of time outside. And I didn't realize until we moved to Marin County, just outside of San Francisco, and my house backs up to a state park. I was mentioning before that, you know, I spend a lot of time up hiking up, and there's 100 miles of trails behind my house, and I'm up there with my Labradors and every morning. So I hike, you know, between 4 to 6 miles every single day. And it's, you know, that's like on a weekday. I mean, on the weekends, I'm up there even longer, and it's really my sanctuary. And I think being able to discover things and being curious about things, it's never, every day is new.
I'm going to make a leap here and say that maybe that's part of the connection to, I mean, you know, the product that you make brings a little bit of nature into your life, yeah. You know, with the flavor of actual natural fruit and water, which is, we all need to sustain life. I think maybe there's a thread that runs from your life or from that interest in nature, maybe into the current business.
Yeah. I just feel like getting outside solves a lot of problems, right? For people that it's just, even when you're frustrated, when you're, you know, yeah. Just bring out, it used to be I used to do a ton of running. Now I hike more and get outside. I, you know, don't usually have headphones on or anything. I just really enjoy. And I, you know, I listen for things, and it's, you know, it's great just to really appreciate nature. And that just continues to be more and more of something that I really find really powerful.
Great. All right. So I have I have 2 more questions. One is is there a brand that that you really admire, and why do you admire that brand?
Why do I admire that brand? You know, Nike is one that I've really, I mean, one of my favorite books was Phil Knight's, you know, book. It was just a great book, and also talks about, you know, you think it's so perfect and they've got everything figured out. And certainly I don't think that's the case. Right. So I think it's like an iconic brand that I really, you know, appreciate. It's interesting. I think that there are a lot of brands that you know, one in particular is Chobani, just because I know Hamdi and I just really like him, but I'm not much of a yogurt. He doesn't like me saying this, but I'm just not, it's not anything against him. I just
either you are, you're not. Right.
Yeah. But I appreciate the discovery of, you know, how it got started and sort of the background of it. I think that that's another thing when I think that the storytelling around brands is very meaningful to me. And I think that it's very meaningful to consumers that when they can't attach a story to a brand, then I think it becomes old, right? It becomes, you know, less in touch, right? And I think it's a good and a bad thing, especially when you've got, you know, the founder still at the company, because we've seen, you know, situations where it's sort of backfired, right? It's founders, you know, behaving badly where they started, you know, at a good place. I mean, Uber, I think, is one of them, right? Solving a problem. And then it just got like the train was running off the rails. And I think that there's so many stories like that. Apple. I mean, for me, you know, I had an Apple computer that I saved my pennies to buy when I was in college because I didn't want to use a typewriter to type my journalism papers. And, you know, when the first iMacs came out, I'd say if I had one regret, it's that I didn't keep that stupid iMac. Like
it's a collector's item now, right?
With me, I was like, it was getting old, and, you know, and now of course I've had like every iPod version, and I've kept all the little, you know, before there was a phone, there were just music, right? I have all of those because I really appreciated it. And I think that the thing that I really appreciate the most about Apple is, and particularly when Steve Jobs was there, but, you know, I think Tim Cook has done a good job too. You could argue that, but I think he has as well, is that it was always, every one of their products was really about, is this going to be useful to the consumer? Right. And it was, I think that when I understand the history and I understand the purpose and I understand, you know, is this product actually adding something to a consumer's life in some way? That's where I really start to get excited about it, right? That there's a thought process behind it versus, you know, so many others that are out there who will remain nameless that are just doing it for the money, right? To sell people stuff.
Yeah. And to your point earlier, it's both being useful to the consumer, but also successfully telling the story to the consumer about why, you know, the why, right? And we always talk about, you know, Simon Sinek book, Start With Why, you know, why does your company exist? Your company exists because you were unhealthy and you thought there was a better alternative that would make you more healthy, and it did, and it worked. And so part of the story for you, I think, is that journey from, you know, unhealthy Kara drinking lots of diet soda, craving something better than just plain water, to today solving that same problem for millions of consumers that drink Hint on a regular basis. By the way, I hear every morning your sponsorship of NPR. So I appreciate that as well, even for our local affiliate here in Atlanta. But this is a perfect way to wrap up. I really appreciate this conversation. Kara Goldin is the founder and CEO of Hint Water and also the author of Undaunted. And so go buy Hint, go read the book, and thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, everyone.